So it's my pleasure to introduce Bülent Tosun from University of Alabama. He's going to tell us today about embedding problems for three manifolds in four space.
Well, thank you so much, Kyler, and the other organizer for the invitation and for giving me the opportunity to speak here. Today, I would like to tell you about some recent joint work with Tom Mark. The title sounds a little bit maybe something more in low dimensional topology realm. But indeed, it will be a symplectic geometry talk. I'd like to tell about a set of questions and conjectures in symplectic geometry, but also in complex function theory. And a couple of particular goals are, on the symplectic side, I would like to talk about contact type hypersurfaces in R4 with its standard symplectic structure. And on the complex side, I'll be interested in Stein domains in C2, with varying degree of convexity. And finally, I would like to talk about a version of symplectic holomorphic rigidity phenomenon in low dimensions and provide some new examples. So these questions are studied by many other people. Here are a few who studied this question, not just in low dimension, but also in high dimensions and produced many important results. And certainly, at least some of these people were very inspiring for our work. And hopefully it will be clear today, our techniques and results will be rather complementary to what they did, which I think it just kind of points out the rich aspect of these questions and possible progress. Okay, so I believe I have enough time. I'll be very happy if you have questions to stop me. When I talk, it's possible that I might get too excited and not see if there is any question in the chat or something. Feel free to make a noise or something that I can stop and you know, answer your question. Okay, so I would like to start with a motivational classic question, which if you care, it is a problem in Kirby's list. It's asked about the following one, which closed oriented three manifolds embed in R4, and it is equivalent that you ask it then best in S4. It's a classic question, and it is right away too much to expect to be true for all closed oriented three manifolds. Indeed, simple algebra topological obstruction says that, for example, length spaces cannot embed in R4. So if you then kind of take the first homology away, this simple obstruction disappears, and that's what we'll be focusing on mainly today. Namely, we'll be dealing with the homology sphere, integer homology spheres. And when you assume this, then indeed the answer to this question suddenly becomes rather hopeful. At least in the topological category, you can always achieve this. You can embed any three manifold, in R4. In locally flat fashion. So it's a result of Friedman from 1982. On the other hand, when you look at the question in the smooth category, it's much more difficult, and the question is largely open. So our goal today is to impose additional geometric conditions on the embedding to obtain more uniform results. So in this talk, I hopefully will achieve this goal already. But there is also maybe a long-term goal in studying this embedding question in the presence of these additional geometric conditions, namely that we would like to also hopefully extract some new information about smooth form manifolds. So just to give you an example, for example, this contrast between the knowledge we have about what happens in topological category versus smooth category, for example, shows the existence of closed form manifolds with no smooth structure. And one goal will be that, okay, what could be a contrast between, let's say, you know, going from smooth category to this new, you know, somehow more restricted embeddings that respects various geometric structures around. This is a long-term goal, but maybe in the discussion session, I might talk about a concrete idea towards that. Okay, so now in the next slide, I would like to talk a little bit more about this smooth category. So I just would like to give maybe some examples and then also talk about some constraints so that we just kind of have a maybe a better idea where things are in the smooth category. Okay, so for the examples part, I would like to consider this particular manifold or a family of manifold, if you wish, so-called Mazur manifold. So what you see here is a four manifold given by a single 0, 1, 2 handle. And then you can easily check that this two handle is attached along a circle, a knot that links the one handle algebraically once, that in particular tells you that this is indeed a contractible manifold. And hence the boundary is a homology sphere, and depending the framing and the attaching circle, this could be an interesting four manifold, and the boundary three manifold as well might be very interesting. Now, what we can prove for this, not just the boundary, but the entire four manifold indeed smoothly embeds in R4. And if you have never seen it, this is a nice trick, goes back to Mazur, known as Mazur trick, or you can call it doubling trick. And the idea is that you thicken your four manifold by crossing with interval. And when you do that, you don't change the handle structure. It still has the same handle structure, but now the two handle is attached along a knot in S1 cross S3. And as a result, you can just undo this crossing. And in particular, now the two handle will not just attach or link the one handle algebraically once, but also geometrically once. In other words, we can cancel them. So what we'll have is just then a zero handle, a five-dimensional zero handle. In other words, this thickened manifold is nothing but fivefold, and that tells you that how Xn indeed sits in its boundary, which is S4, and hence in R4. So now, as you realize that during this kind of simple trick proof, I really didn't use anything about the framing, or I didn't use anything about the attaching circle. You can implement this for any attaching circle, for any framing. In particular, as you change to these two, you will get many three manifolds on the boundary, and typical examples to get are hyperbolic three manifolds. But there are many situations, infinite families, you also get actually Seifert fibered manifolds. And I listed some people there who provided the first examples of this. So now these Seifert manifolds arise here, these Seifert homology spheres, they are indeed much more special than just being Seifert manifold. Indeed, they come from a very particular construction in complex geometry. So for this, let me briefly remind you what is a Brieskorn sphere. A Brieskorn sphere is nothing but a link of this particular complex hypersurface singularity. Here I choose PQR to be relatively prime. That is what gives me that sigma PQR is indeed a homology sphere. So they admit an S1 action, and you can use it to write a rather nice surgery picture for these three manifolds. Here, P prime, Q prime, R prime are any integers that satisfy this equality, this equation. Now, you can actually similarly define an analogous picture for general Brieskorn sphere, where instead of the three parameters, you have actually n of them. And the picture is very similar. All you see is like, instead of the maybe, let's say, n meridional curve with various surges on them, you have n of them and with various kind of the information. And again, this A1 prime through AM prime will satisfy a single equation similar to this one. So the nice thing about these Brieskorn spheres, as the picture already indicates, they are Seifert fibered manifolds. And not just that, when you focus in the case of homology spheres, indeed, any Seifert homology sphere is a Brieskorn sphere, possibly changing with changing the orientation. So this is very handy. So this manifolds already come in a very special way, these Seifert fiber spaces. So now next, I would like to talk about a couple of the constraints on smooth embedding question. So for that, first I will make a small observation. So if you have a three manifold, an integer homology ball that admits a smooth embedding in R4, then that necessarily the compact region it bounds is a homology ball. So then, if you want to study this question, you might try to attempt a possibly harder question, namely try to think about or find obstruction for integer homology spheres to bound homology balls, regardless of they are in R4 or not. In other words, you can try to kind of study various homology cobordism invariants, and they will help you to, for example, prevent for a such obstruction to happen. And indeed, the very first example of the, this kind of let's say research program is you know comes from Rocklin invariant from 1952. Namely, by using Rocklin invariant, you can prevent many three manifolds to embed smoothly in R4. As an example, Poincaré sphere is one of such. And with our notation, Poincaré sphere is nothing but sigma 2, 3, 5 in the previous notation. So it is a good invariant, but it's not a complete invariant. And there has been, since 1952, many homology cobordism invariants coming from gauge theory, floor theories, and otherwise. And they have been very powerful. For example, Monolowska has the integer lift of Rocklin invariant, very powerful. There is an invariant specific for Brieskorn spheres, so-called the Fintuschel Stearns R invariant, and many others. And on the other hand, there are also conjectures. First time I saw this was stated explicitly in a 2006 paper of Kollar, that if you consider indeed Brieskorn spheres sigma A1 through AN, you will never be able to write them as the boundary of an integer homology ball if n is greater than 3. And as far as I know, this conjecture is completely open. That is, I am not aware of any progress. So all to say here is that the situation in smooth case is really complicated. And that is the case even if you restrict to Brieskorn spheres. So that's where we are in the smooth question. And our idea is to kind of, for sake of making progress, is asking embeddings that they satisfy some version of convexity. And I would like to consider two types of convexity here. One is in complex settings, so-called holomorphic convexity. Namely, we will ask three manifolds to be embedded in R4, and we will consider it to be C2 and with this complex manifold structure, and ask for Y to bound a Stein domain in C2. And the other version of convexity we'll consider is so-called symplectic convexity. Now here we will require Y, this three manifold, to be indeed a contact type hypersurface in R4 with the standard symplectic structure. Okay, so and we will see a bit more concretely. Even though Stein manifolds and symplectic manifolds are quite related, but we will see that in this symplectic convexity is more constraining than homomorphic convexity. Okay, so now for the next part of the talk, I would like to briefly talk about this issue of this convexity. So I'm sure that people are somewhat familiar with this already, but just to be on the same page, let me try to revisit each a little bit. So first I would like to start with the holomorphic convexity. Here, the notion of convexity relevant to us is pseudo-convexity. And indeed, always there is like a further objective, it should be strictly pseudo-convex domains will be interested. So remember that Stein manifolds are this complex manifolds that means proper holomorphic embedding in some complex affine space, necessarily non-compact. But then we know that by work of Graut, they are those that they admit a particularly nice Morse function that what we call it J convex, where J refers to the complex structure of the manifold. And J convexity, essentially, you should think about this as okay, it produces you a positive definite symmetric form. In other words, it produces a metric for you. So, one question that since the essentially work of Graut, once we have this nice Morse function around, that already puts strong restrictions on the topology of manifold. And what is so amazing though, that this kind of the basic restriction that comes from Graut results are indeed also sufficient to put a Stein structure on a manifold. In that respect, I would remind you this important characterization result of Eliasberg, which says that if you are given a smooth 2-dimensional manifold, putting the structure of a Stein structure on this manifold is that you just need an almost complex structure, and then you need a nice handle decomposition, namely no handles of index greater than m. So, and indeed, this is all you need if you are in complex dimension 3 and above. If you're in complex dimension 2, or if you're in the setting of a smooth for manifold case, you actually don't need to worry about almost complex structure that is automatically there, but now there is an additional framing condition that kind of need to be satisfied. So I would like to here kind of emphasize on one thing is that, okay, here, this is the point is that, okay, these are the conditions that gives you that how we can set a Stein structure abstractly on a given smooth manifold. So as I mentioned, Stein manifolds are necessarily non-compact. Often we'll be interested to study compact pieces of Stein manifolds, so-called the Stein domains, which are the sub-levels of this J-convex function around. So you can find Stein domains of a Stein manifold in two ways. The easy way is that you just restrict the, look at the sub-levels of sets of the given J-convex function. And this is good, but it is expected in this case that the level sets will have a rather kind of the determined topology. An alternative question will be that you might ask that, okay, maybe you have a Stein manifold and you happen to know a codimension zero submanifold of it. And you might ask that, what does it take to isotope this submanifold to be a Stein submanifold of this given Stein manifold, this ambient question. And obviously that kind of there are requirements for it. This codimension zero submanifold should have in some ways an abstract Stein structure on it. If you don't have it, because even if you find a J-convex function in the neighborhood of this codimension zero submanifold, that will provide a Stein structure on the submanifold. So it should be Stein abstractly, and it should also have a smooth embedding inside this Stein manifold or complex manifold. And then if you have this condition, there's a nice result due to Gonf. We would like to call it Gonf flexibility. It essentially tells you that is all you need to make it Stein inside that complex manifold or Stein manifold. Gonf's result is much more general, but I will state it for integral homology balls. And the result goes exactly what I said, namely if this domain is actually happen to carry in some abstract Stein structure, and you know that it embeds in R4 or C2, then indeed you can make it Stein domain inside in C2. A domain of this kind, we will call it holomorphically convex, and indeed in the case of C2, these are also known as domain of holomorphy. So very good. So what might be some examples of this holomorphically convex domains? Like, I mean, how do you find examples? Here's a way to create many holomorphically convex domains in C2. Let's go back to our toy example. Let's look at this Maser manifold. So if you remembered by using Maser trick, we saw that this is indeed at least a smooth embedding in R4. And moreover, if you look at this four manifold, it has the right handle structure to implement the Eliashberg's criteria, except that remember that we are in dimension four, there is a framing condition. And that framing condition requires that you make the attaching circle Legendrian. So it's not quite Legendrian, but it's not a big deal. You just have to fix crossings if needed and convert the vertical tangencies to particular cusps, which you can, and then calculate the so-called the Thurston-Banneker number of it. These are easy calculations to do. And indeed, in this case, you can do it so that the Thurston-Banneker at hand is exactly minus one. Exactly minus one. And the additional framing condition in Eliashberg's characterization is that the framing should be exactly the Thurston-Banneker minus one. So in other words, whenever I have this framing and is less than minus one, I should be able to achieve to be TB minus one. So in that case, I can make it Stein by using Eliashberg's criteria. But now we are dealing with a contractible manifold, in particular it's an integral homology ball. So these conditions are also enough by using Gomp's result that indeed this Xn is holomorphically convex in C2. And hence it's boundary bounds a Stein domain in C2. So this is how, for example, you find many, many examples. So of course, one is curious, okay, what happens if n is equal to minus one? And this was a question, so one thing you observe, first of all, if n is equal to minus one, the boundary here is actually one of the special Brieskorn sphere, namely it is the sigma 2313. This was first written by Akbulut Kirby a couple decades ago. And then the question was that, okay, is this domain Stein? I mean, maybe there is a clever way you can increase the TB. Tom Mark and myself proved a few years ago that indeed.
Brad, did you say TB is minus one? I'm getting TB plus one.
I guess if you check it, maybe give an orientation. I think this all this will be the both.
There are two plus two from the class and minus one from that crossing.
Yeah, but this crossing is wrong. You need to fix it by introducing a cusp.
Oh, the. Yeah, okay, after you introduce the cusp. Okay, this good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So this particular contractible manifold, when n is equal to minus one, we did prove that it indeed cannot be made Stein. And indeed, we proved something stronger. It cannot be made Stein with either orientation. So this was a question, I guess. It was like, you know, maybe ask, I mean, if the topology is right, can you achieve to make something Stein? And well, we proved, well, indeed you can't. But in reality, there is a much deeper reason that why this would not be the case. And that is this kind of rather remarkable conjecture by Gonf, which says that indeed, Brieskorn homology spheres will never bound a Stein domain in situ. And indeed, that should be the case with either orientation. So just to kind of really emphasize, you know, like why this conjecture is not at all trivial, I mean, Brieskorn spheres are link of complex hypersurface singularity. Hence, they always bond Stein manifolds. So-called Milner fiber is provides a Stein filling for a particular contact structure on this three manifolds. That's one thing. And also that as we saw earlier, like Brieskorn spheres, you know, there are many, many infinite families of them do admit smooth embedding in C2R4. So conjecture is not at all obvious or trivial. And as far as I know, the only progress for this first conjecture is this previous theorem and I said, and also the conjecture holds for this infinite family. So, and our motivation mainly was really to kind of studying these questions was to go after this conjecture. So we had some progress, but it stopped here. So this is all I wanted to say about holomorphic convexity. I will return to it in a bit to see how it is really related with the symplectic and contact geometry. But let me kind of switch to the other type of convexity for our purpose, namely symplectic convexity. And there, as I said, we are asking for this Y in R4 with the standard symplectic structure to bound a symplectically convex domain. Equivalently, that will say that Y is a contact type hypersurface in R4. So the picture you should have in mind is that I guess this is my picture, let's say for R4 with a standard symplectic structure, and Y gotta be a codimension zero, a hypersurface in R4. And then and what you should find for it to be a contact type hypersurface in R4 is existence of this level vector field that pointing outward. So and once you find such a vector field, then this compact region here W will be a convex filling of Y, or it will be a symplectically convex domain. So and this is what I just wrote here. The picture I just drew was just explaining this bullet point. So what are some examples of contact type hypersurfaces or symplectically convex domain? There are obvious ones, namely four ball or one handle. And of course, there are also various disk bundles, including T2 cross D2, but many more studied by Nemirovsky and Siegel. Okay, so this is symplectic convexity. And like one maybe last slide, and maybe this will also help to revisit again how we think about Stein manifolds, you know, being available on a manifold abstractly versus ambiently. So the picture you see here, this cartoon picture, I have a Stein manifold X together with this complex structure J and J convex function phi. And in it, as you see, I have a submanifold W, which arises as a is a sub-level set of yet another J-convex function, but this time F. This F here I drew doesn't have to be a restriction of phi to W. This F is possibly a J-convex function only available in some neighborhood of W. What W and X have in common is J. That's what we are saying. So now, a couple of the comments. I already indicated it, but let me write it officially. So Stein domains they carry a Keller structure, a Keller form, which is this one, just captured by the involved J convex function and the complex structure. And boundaries are naturally contact, the level sets, and the contact structure is gotten by these complex tangencies. And also that you naturally get a symplectic convexity, because this Keller structure gives you a metric. You can look at the gradient of the function with respect to that metric. That is indeed a Liouville vector field for the symplectic form or Keller form omega f. So in that respect, W is symplectically convex with respect to omega f. But here is an important warning: is that this even if you are in C2, here X could be arbitrary, but even if you are in C2, the form omega f does not have to agree with the standard symplectic structure on C2. In other words, even though boundary of W is contact type with respect to omega f, it doesn't have to be contact type with respect to the standard symplectic structure. So this Keller form doesn't necessarily doesn't have to extend to a Keller form on C2. But it is it's a natural question to ask is when does that happen? And the domains that this happen are precisely rationally convex domains. So the relevant theorem here is this independent work of Duval, Saboni, and Nemirovsky, and some improvements by Eliasberg Silibak, who prove that indeed this omega f will extend to a Keller form on Cn precisely on rationally convex domains. And indeed, you can even take this extension to be agreeing with the standard Keller form omega standard outside of a compact set. And I want you to take the domain, the definition of rational convexity to be exactly this theorem. But indeed, in complex function theory literature, rationally convex domains are, it has its own definition. We don't have to revisit it. And then their importance is that these are the domains on which holomorphic functions can be uniformly approximated by rational functions. So they're very important in complex function theory, and their relation to symplectic geometries via this theorem. Okay, so rationally convex domains are necessarily holomorphically convex, in other words. So just to summarize where we are, so far I have talked about various geometric conditions and equivalences, and this is where this kind of the various implication we have. So for a given three manifold, we might be interested in bonding as simple as a homology bold, or embedding in R4 smoothly, or bond being a contact type hypersurface. This is the land of more symplectic geometry, or they bond a homomorphically convex domain, or being pseudo convex, or them bonding a rationally convex domain, or being rationally convex. So my goal is then now to maybe state some results to see what are some whys that could, like, what do we know about these whys? Or are there ways that, okay, we can prevent them to exist in particular in these categories? And a later question will be to see how can we understand whether these implications can be reversed or how these two are related, etc. So this will be what I will do next. And let me state the first main result, I guess. So it turns out that for Brieskorn spheres, we have the following result. Indeed, they will never embed the contact type hypersurface in R4 with the standard symplectic structure. So, and as a corollary, and as a, I guess, partial evidence to conjectures of both Kollar and Gompf, we get that indeed no Brieskorn homology sphere will bond a rationally convex domain in C2. And I guess maybe one moral here is that, just again to you know, remind people, these questions were extremely difficult in the smooth category. So we are far from having any satisfying answer, even for Brieskorn spheres on three parameters, for them to know when do they admit a smooth embedding in R4, when they don't. So on the other hand here, once you impose the requirement of, you know, being contact type hypersurface, we can get a uniform no answer. Okay.
So the orientation preserving condition, is it, do you know any examples where it actually does admit an embedding with the opposite orientation, or it's just not known?
Oh, it's really not known. It's a very good question. So I will pose it at the end as a question, like in general, like, you know, what do we know? Do we know anything other than S3, which admits a contact type, which can be contact type hypersurface in R4? There's a conjecture that there are none other than S3. And this orientation condition on sigma, it's possible that if you look at it with the other orientation, it might just be that just the contact geometry might be enough to take care of most of the stuff, but we don't know.
Bülent, I have a question.
Sure.
What's an example of the Brieskorn homology sphere or any homology sphere bounding symplectic convex domain, but not holomorphically convex domain? Do we know those examples?
So I do know that those that they bound holomorphically convex, but not I know those, and I will give it in the next slide.
Okay, good.
But maybe your question was the other way around, and I don't have an answer for that. But maybe next.
Go ahead.
Maybe the next slide will say some more. Okay, these are the kind of, if you wish, some sort of, like, you know, obstruction type results. And I just would like to kind of a little bit talk about maybe some further results, in particular, just tell about this contrast between low and high dimensions. So this notion of holomorphic convexity and rational convexity and one other polynomial convexity, which will come later on, are studied in complex dimension 3 and above as well. And indeed, a recent result of Silibak-Eliasberg says that holomorphic and rational convexity in complex dimension 3 and above are equivalent. There is no distinction. And as a result, they also find many contact type hypersurfaces in R2M with its standard symplectic structure. Indeed, once we have a codimensional zero submanifold with the right topology, which means that right handle structure, we can make them to be Weinstein with respect to this standard symplectic structure. In particular, the boundaries will be contact type hypersurfaces. On the other hand, in dimension 4, there are restrictions. There are domains in C2 which are holomorphically convex, but not rationally convex. And the first such example was given by Nemirovsky-Siegel. They studied disk bundles over surfaces. Here is their example here. It's a disk bundle over RP2 with Euler number -2. The boundary of this is, as you see, it's a rational homology ball. If you just check that, the algebraic intersection is not 1 anymore, it is 2. It's a beautiful example. They studied these bundles, but among those, there is only one that is a rational homology sphere, the boundary, which is this one. And it just, the argument rests on the fact that there are no Lagrangian Klein bottle in R4 with standard symplectic structure. So we came up with this infinite family. This is WN. These are contractable manifolds. These are examples well studied, Salmon being one of them. What we can do, so you can easily check that this can be given a Stein structure, an abstract Stein structure, and because it's the Maser type, it's contractable. Indeed, it is holomorphically convex in C2, but we prove that they cannot be rationally convex. So surprisingly, as we come to the proof, I will explain what is our obstruction to prevent something to be rationally convex. Whatever that obstruction, surprisingly or interesting enough, it doesn't apply to this example. So it's kind of, it's really, their results are really complementary that way. So, but one corollary of this and and it's also the corollary of Kyler's and Stefan's result, is that indeed on this domain Wn, and also this example, let's call it Ns, you cannot find a compatible one-strain structure that embeds symplectically in R4 with omega standard. I mean, these domains will have a one-strain structure, but you wouldn't be able to find one that is compatible with the ambient symplectic structure, just because if so, they will be necessarily symplectic convex, but we are saying that they can't be. Okay, so any questions so far?
Wait, did you say Wn's Stein?
Yes, Wn is Stein. So to see it, why it is abstractly Stein, you can just
check. That I can check. No. That I can check. So that's abstractly Stein. You can do that, and then no compatible Weinstein structure. So it does. It's not a boundary of a symplectic, convex symplectic domain.
Exactly. It is Wn is not symplectically It is Stein in C2.
C2, yes.
So namely, it is holomorphically convex because it is abstractly Stein and it sits inside C2. And because it's contractible, you can make it Stein inside. So you can isotope it to be Stein in C2.
Okay.
But you cannot isotope it to be symplectically convex in C2.
Okay. Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So very good. Very good. So, okay. If there are no more questions, maybe I will go ahead and say how the proof goes. What do you do for the proof? What goes into the proof? Okay, so let's look at the proof. So for our proof, we will in the first step, I will derive an obstruction from Hegel floor homology. Even though our obstruction will be coming from Hegel floor homology, I just want to point out that we have to use actually just multiple packages of floor theory in dimension three to be able to recover this result. So it's unfortunately it's not a result you can just use Hegel floor homology, and you will see why. Anyhow, so maybe a little bit input, what is this? So Hegel floor homology groups are groups associated attached to a three manifold. And once there's a contact structure around, you can capture some sort of distinguished class that tells you a lot about the contact geometry of the three manifold. And if you are symplectically convex, then indeed the contact structure on the boundary, this distinguished class always have to be a non-zero class. All classic facts about this, and our obstruction is the following theorem. If your domain in R4 happen to be symplectically convex, then indeed there is a restriction on this contact class. It has to be image of this natural map. For those in maybe Hegel floor, they will also recognize that what this is saying is that this Hegel floor homology groups, it has this kind of the infinite dimensional piece, namely a tower, but then it also has this reduced part, namely the finite dimensional piece. So what this result is saying that the contact class will be zero in that reduced part, in that finite dimensional part. So and of course, this will then give you an obstruction to contact type embedding in R4. So let's see how we will implement, how we can prove this result, at least just kind of the just basic idea of this theorem. So to prove this this fact, we assume W is symplectically convex inside C2. So I take a large ball around W. W sits in interior of this ball, and I look at this region from W to the boundary of this four ball. So call this region this cobordism C. And if you equip this cobordism with the standard symplectic structure from R4, because of this symplectic convexity in this cobordism will be a strong symplectic cobordism. So now once this is the case, and here is the input we need from not just Hegel floor, but from monopole floor. When that is the case, we can talk about an induced map in monopole floor homology, and that has a naturality property, namely it kind of descends the contact class to the contact class. And since the one of the three manifold involved here is extremely simple, namely S3. We have a good understanding of this monofold throw homology. That is how we obtain the obstruction in the theorem. Really, the kind of the key point of the result is knowing this nature of the result. And now we would like to, even though we capture the result by using monopole floor, we would like to go back to Hegar floor homology. And I'm really happy to cite these two results, which are extremely long papers, but nevertheless, they give us the equivalence between monopole and Hegar floor. We use
that. Was this strongly symplectic cobordism?
Say it again.
What is strongly symplectic cobordism? Definition of this.
Yeah, it is just that I have a dual field that is pointing in to the region and pointing out. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. And then the symplectic structure here that does that is the standard symplectic structure, restricted from R4. Using these two results, we can pass to Hegar floor homology, and that is the length we want to be, because now we're going to move and try to see why this is really an obstruction for Brieskorn homology spheres. Okay, so we have an obstruction, and now our goal will be that for any relevant contact structure on the Brieskorn homology spheres, its contact class fails to satisfy the condition in the previous theorem. And if we do that, then we know that three manifolds cannot bound a symplectic convex domain, or they cannot be contact type hypersurfaces. So now a naive approach to this will be that you will say, okay, I'm just going to go understand contact geometry of these Brieskorn spheres, and that's going to be a way to do it. But if you have a little bit of experience with it, this is an extremely difficult task to try to do. So these three manifolds, like if you have, for example, more than three singular three parameters, they are toroidal. They have incompressible torus in them. Automatically, you have infinitely many contact structures. And indeed, this infinitely manyness could arise in many ways. So it's complicated. So you should kind of maybe for the sake of what you are trying to do, maybe you don't need the entire contact geometry of the three manifolds at hand. So our goal will be kind of something else. And let me kind of say what is that. So I need to tell you a little bit about the structure of Hegar floor homology. So as I said, it has this the infinite part, which is the tower, and it has this finite dimensional piece, which we call it reduced. So now this contact class has this property that it lies in the kernel of U. And what is this U is that this tower part is this kind of I should call it F. Typically it is Z2. This is the tower part. It goes like this, and we have the HF reduced here. And the U map is this map, this kind of endomorphism, that degree two endomorphism. And this contact class is known to lie in the kernel of U. Again, piece of structure for Hegar floor homology. And finally, this bottom generator, this bottom Z2, its generator is kind of the, again, a structure. Okay, if you look at this bottom generator, and if you have a contact type embedding, then indeed seek psi gotta be equal to this bottom generator. This is because of the theorem we set. If you have a contact type embedding, the contact class have to be zero in this finite dimensional piece. Then it really has to lie in the tower. But if it is lying in the tower and it is in the kernel, then necessarily it is actually in the bottom, namely it is that generator. Okay, so then here is then our strategy. Our strategy is that first, the following information. If you give me any class in Hegar floor homology, I can associate it to that a knot invariant, so-called, maybe people will remember it as the tau invariant for knots in S3. That was kind of the first of such invariant developed and turned to be very powerful to study knot theory and three manifold topology. But this is a process you can, in the case of tau invariant, you do it for knots in S3, there is really just kind of this kind of the obvious generator people study. There isn't much, but you can study this on arbitrary three manifolds. You can a priori do it for arbitrary classes. It's just that you might not be able to have a good understanding of what you got at the end. But this is our goal. And then what we're gonna do, we will find a knot in our Brieskorn sphere, a particular knot. It will be so-called a regular fiber because it has a Seifert fiber structure. And for which we will prove that if you look at the relevant knot invariant tau with respect to class, contact class CXC, and with respect to the theta plus, this particular generator, they will have different invariants. That will in particular say that indeed then this contact class and this particular generator, they are not same. And that means that no contact type embedding. Okay, so like sometimes we call this one like contact tau, because it's a tau that comes from the using contact class. And this one sometimes called smooth tau, because this is always there regardless of the contact structure. You can always talk about the bottom generator in the tower and look at the corresponding tau. And if you're in the case of S3, these two overlap. There is no distinction because there is no reduced part for the S3. Okay, so this is our strategy. So now how can we prove that these two quantities are really different from each other? So, and of course the natural thing is that we will try to look at their difference and try to estimate it. Try to see that, you know, maybe find the lower bound on them. And if you're lucky, we'll prove that that lower bound is positive. Okay, so that is the kind of the part. So the knot I promised you here will be a regular fiber. So if I consider my Brieskorn sphere something like this.
So just to make sure I understand, so you said like for most of these Brieskorn manifolds, there's not like a classification of the contact structure. So you're proving this, so you have some understanding of the contact structure. So you're proving this inequality for sort of any hypothetical contact structure.
Exactly. And that is coming. That will be the third part. So I will not need to know entire contact geometry or the classification of contact structure. That's a difficult task. But as you will see in a bit in the next slide, we will understand something about contact geometry, and it will be good enough for what we are doing.
I see.
So the knot I will take, these are my kind of A1 over A1 prime, I guess, all the way to AN over AN prime. This is my background Brieskorn manifold, and my K will be this regular fiber. This is the K here. My goal is to go ahead and compare the tau invariant of the tau invariance for this regular fiber with respect to contact class and with respect to theta plus, and see that they are different. So I will get estimates on each of these taus. Okay, so getting estimate on tau will use some earlier work of Matt Hedden, and where he gives an upper bound on the Thurston-Benneken of a knot in terms of the contact tau. For our purpose, because we are in a Seifert fibered manifold, typically Thurston-Benneken number is this the contact framing, but measured with respect to the Seifert framing if you have a null homologous knot around. In our case, we are in a Seifert fibered case, you know, our knot is getting a framing from the Seifert structure, and we want to kind of compare the contact framing to that. And that is kind of what's known as twisting number of the contact structure. And we will just replace TB with that. And when we do that, this theorem already gives us a lower bound on the contact tau for K. This is good. Now, the next bit of information, getting an upper bound for the smooth tau, there we will use multiple theorems developed by Rao and Hedden Rao. In that case, if you are given a knot in a negative definite form manifold, then there is an adjunction type inequality as such. And one of the terms here involved is the smooth tau. So this kind of this churn class evaluation, this self-intersection, genus, these are the things that we can need to determine. Genus is easy because in our case, Brieskorn sphere's naturally bound is negative definite plumbing, we are good. And indeed our knot will be slice, genus is not a problem. But these quantities need to be determined. And that could be non-trivial. And indeed, it's a non-trivial calculation to do. But nevertheless, we could do it. And from this, we found that an upper bound on the smooth tau. And if you combine this with the taking the difference of the contact tau and smooth tau, you get a lower bound of this one by estimating all this churn class evaluation and self-intersection. Here is what you get as the lower bound on this difference. Okay, there is twisting, which we know what it is, and there is this kind of the particular quantity given in terms of parameters A1 through AN. So it will be really nice if you can prove that this is a positive quantity. And indeed it is positive because of this theorem. So what we proved, and this is the contact geometry input, we don't know contact the classification of contact structure on Brieskorn sphere. That could be complicated, but what we can prove indeed for any contact structure on these Brieskorn spheres, it doesn't matter they are fillable, tight, or over twisted, no matter which contact structure you take, there's a uniform lower bound on the twisting number, and it is this quantity. So this is what we need. And I would like to say that if you indeed, you know, think about a particular Brieskorn sphere and then try to understand contact structure, often you can make the twisting number much better than that. Often you can make it actually quite close to zero. But the point is that, okay, this theorem doesn't focus on one Brieskorn sphere or anything. It just gives a uniform result that works for any contact structure. And that's it. That is how we get our result. So any questions about anything here? If not, I would like to maybe have a final remark. There is one other type of convexity one can talk about is of polynomial convexity. I would like to revisit that and maybe mention about a couple of more observations we did about them. And then I will like to switch to some questions that they are still there and will be interesting to study. Okay.
Maybe can you just say maybe like one or two words about how you get this bound? Like, is it in the flavor of classification of contact structures, or is it sort of?
It is. The result is the proof is used is implementing the technique of convex surface theory, very much in the spirit of work developed by Giroux, by Honda, others. But there is a new input in it. So as you study this kind of, you try to implement this convex surface theory arguments. The basic idea is that the manifolds you are dealing with are Seifert fiber spaces. They have a nice decomposition as three manifolds. Essentially, you have this bunch of singular fibers. You have a nice neighborhood for them, and there is a complementary piece. Each piece is kind of rather nice. So you can make these individual pieces to be some sort of three manifolds, contact three manifolds with boundary. And your goal is that you are trying to find ways to somehow normalize things so that these neighborhoods are most optimal possible. So that's kind of is a goal, constant goal. You try to then that way make the twisting number, you know, let's say as close to zero as possible. So in doing that, your typical kind of the goal is to find what's called bypasses. These are how they help you to actually increase the twisting number. So there are various kind of important results that you can use. One of the new input here that was really well, that we introduced something called I keep forgetting his name. It's called the, it's called the congruence principle. I'm sorry. So this is something very much in the spirit of various kind of similar results Co-Honda and others developed, but the new input is the congruence principle there that helps you to have some control on the twisting number. Is that good enough, Kyler?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Okay, as I said, let me kind of a little bit look at last bit of, studying these domains. One other type of convexity, that is of polynomial convexity. And again, this is a concept quite important on its own in complex function theory, domains on which holomorphic functions indeed can be uniformly approximated by polynomial holomorphic functions. And we also have a connection between polynomial convexity and symplectic geometry, if you wish. So now in this case, if you remember, we had holomorphically convex domains that was just finding a J-convex function in the neighborhood of the domain. And then, you know, there is a relevant Keller form. Could you extend it to ambient manifold? That was rational convexity. Here, you have even a control, some sort of control on the J-convex function involved. Indeed, what you can do, you can extend the J-convex function to J-convex function on the ambient manifold. So this is the characterization of OCA, and the notion of polynomial convexity, what they might be, whether you can always, whether they have a much restricted topology, was concerned for people like Nemirovsky. He had a question. He was interested. He was asking whether any polynomially convex domain in CM will always be subcritical. So this is not quite true. But there is a conjecture out there, Stilebach and Yoshberg, when they were studying various convexities in higher dimension, they conjectured the following: simply connected polynomial convex domain in CM will be subcritical. Subcritical means that not even middle dimension handles will be allowed. And indeed, it is, according to Yasha, it is possible that in complex dimension two, even simply connectedness will not be needed. So just to point out that this simply connected is essential here. Indeed, in each complex dimension three and above, Stilebach and Yoshberg list a non-simply connected polynomial convex domain, which is not subcritical. So I guess a kind of observation that we had, indeed this first part of the conjecture of Eliashberg, Stilebach Eliashberg, is indeed true. More generally, if you have a polynomially convex domain in C2, and if it either has a simply simply connected or boundary is the rational homology sphere, not even integral homology sphere, rational homology sphere, then indeed the boundary has to be S3 and the four manifold has to be formal. And I think there is a good chance that indeed the strong version of Stilebach Eliashberg conjecture is true. But it's just, we are not there yet. Okay, so this is maybe some last comments about the polynomial convexity. And I'd just like to finish up with some further questions. This is just to answer a question earlier. Kyler asked, yes, we don't know any rational homosphere besides S3 that embeds as a contact type hypersurface in R4. It's possible that they never do. And indeed, this is a conjecture of Chen, who was motivated really looking the question from rather different perspective, more in line with the maybe dynamics and holomorphic curve way. Another question, of course, you might try to study contact type embeddings in other four manifolds, for example, CP2. There is some relevant work there. One can also study, ask similar questions about domains in Stein manifolds other than CN. Eliashberg Stilebach's result likely will be helpful there. So of course I had this kind of the chain of implications I mentioned about looking various relations, how they are related. I gave one example, but there is more to do there. And I think our result also says even more so how this kind of Liouville versus Stein cobordism is important in dimension four. Essentially, our results combined rational convexity and polynomial convexity results says that the distinction between rational convexity and polynomial convexity is precisely this distinction between Liouville and Stein cobordism in dimension four. And of course, we still don't know the answer to Gomes' conjecture. It is still by large open. And if it was true, of course, then it will already take care of all the rational convexity results and so we have. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Okay, so yeah, let's thank the speaker for a very nice talk. So yeah, let's, I guess, open up the floor to questions. So are there any questions for Bülent?
Maybe I should stop sharing the screen just in case people, I can see people as well. So.
Okay.
So maybe I'll start. Regarding this sort of near the end of your talk. There's this question about whether there could exist exotic polynomially convex domains in C2. So it seems like you've almost answered that, or there's just a little bit of room still for.
By exotic, you mean could there be non-simply connected domain that is polynomially convex but not subcritical?
Yeah, or more generally, you could just ask the question, is every polynomially convex domain in C2 symplectomorphic to a connect sum of S1 cross B3s?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think, as I said, we are already got quite close to that, but not yet there. It just seems to be, it's possible that things may be coming to, at least on the, before coming to symplectomorphism question, but why they really have to be subcritical if you start with an arbitrary one. I mean, there are kind of strong restrictions, but it seems to be that maybe things are coming some sort of understanding how the domain piece and the complementary piece, because for these polynomially convex ones, the important piece is that if you have a polynomially convex domain, you can attach to them, at least in the case of dimension four, only one and two handles and reach to four both. In other words, you have a ribbon cobordism. So it's just that it's not very obvious to us yet how you can, even if you start with a domain that it has possibly one, two handles, how you can eliminate so that it has a handle description without two handles. It seems that that has to be the case, but we don't know. I mean, yeah. Smooth form manifold topology is suitable to have some unexpected examples of such. Indeed, we have some candidate examples. Maybe you cannot eliminate two handles, but it's not clear that why they are Stein. So it's just, we are not there yet.
I'd like to say something, since I don't know much topology, but I know quite a bit about polynomial convexity.
Sure.
So there's a question, which basically there's almost nothing known and its topological implications. Let's take a torus in S1 cross C, which submerges onto S1, so it's fibered over the circle. And let's ask, what's the polynomial hull of this? In simple examples, you can just write, the sublevel set of a polynomial. But you see, you could say, let's say the core of this torus is some uninteresting knot. Let's say the core is not quasi-positive, for instance. And then I would like to prove, and I have some very simple examples where I can do this. I'd like to say, in that case, one could not have polynomial hull. The polynomial hull, if it's nice enough, will give you a polynomial convex domain. But you see, if you can eliminate some kind of examples like this, then it's a way of saying that certain tori must not have polynomial hull, which covers the base disk. And that's interesting in complex analysis. And again, I'll write to you about this.
Okay. Oh, that would be great. Yeah. I mean,
but that's a question I've had a lot of headache about. And so.
Since there is a small group of people, if you wish, I have one last slide. I mentioned about some discussion, and maybe in the discussion part, we can talk about an idea how these things could be used to study smooth form manifolds. Are people interested? I'm happy to answer questions, but if you want, I can share this bonus slide as well.
Bonus slide.
Or I could phrase it as a question. The question is, can we see your bonus slide?
Okay, then. So I guess, I want to fully attribute this to Weimin Chan. This is definitely his idea, but maybe I try to just rewrite it so that, So what should you be interested? So, this is obviously not a question, only question to me, I perfectly like the symplectic aspect of the what we did and what we can do. But here is maybe something for people who really wants to understand smooth form manifold. So here is, for example, a situation. Suppose that you have a three manifold with the following properties. On one side, you know that it bonds a holomorphically convex domain. And just what happened to be a rational homology ball. Okay? So we have examples of loss of this kind. But now here is something that we don't want it to embed in CP2 as a contact type hypersurface. So as you see, I changed my target manifold. I made it CP2. And indeed, I can already tell you examples like this. We know examples like this. So for example, just Kyler is here. Kyler and Stefan came up an example like this, right? They're this bundle over RP2 with other number -2. The boundary is a particular Brieskorn sphere. And particular Seifert cyberspace, And it has these properties. It bonds homomorphically convex, which is a rational homology ball, but it does not embed in CP2 as a contact type hypersurface. And indeed, why it will not embed in CP2 as a contact type hypersurface is exactly the proof they did why it is not rationally convex in C2. The same proof. So now, and suppose now that this is the part might be a little bit harder, that this domain has a concave cap, but with rather small topology. So for example, it is simply connected and has B21, or maybe simply connected will be too much to ask, then in that case, at least B1 should be zero. If you can find a domain like this, then you can form this, glue these pieces, the domain X, which has these two properties and this cap you found, and you find this, if this is a simply connected one, you indeed have to yourself an exotic CP2. And maybe you will not be able to find a simply connected one. If you can find something with B10, then in that case, maybe it's not an exotic CP2, but you have something like a symplectic rational CP2.
It bonds holomorphically convex domain in R4, right? In the first hypothesis.
Yes, in C2. And if it is if it bonds holomorphically convex in C2, you can always push it inside CP2. We can always just have a holomorphic embedding in CP2. Yeah, I mean, just bonding in C2 is good enough.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and the importance of, like, even if you cannot find quite an exotic CP2, but synthetic rational CP2, is that this is something, at least, to Chen, it's really interesting, and you can see why. Like, we have a classification of algebraic CP2s, or fake CP2s, like after orientation, there are 50 of them. So the point is, okay, could you have some symplectic but not algebraic ones? So, I mean, even this part is interesting. So, as I said, like, this is, to me, this is like a really concrete example where you might be able to study this kind of the passage from the land of smooth world. I mean, indeed, in this case, we don't even compare smooth world to this more, maybe, let's say, embeddings that, equip these geometric structures. But indeed, we equip these embeddings with geometric structures, but we have many such. We have one that, bonds Stein domain, but like maybe somewhat weaker, but something stronger, looking that contrast. And I think it has potential, but of course there are stages that need to be completed. So someone might I already mentioned that, the example that Kyler and Stefan have, and the examples we have, they satisfy this. The question, okay, do they satisfy the third one, right? Can you find a cap for them, a small cap? I mean, there is a strategy out there how you can find this cap. I mean, if you can find the tree manifold, it's at least oppositely oriented, by a suitable surgery on a knot in S3, there is a procedure by David Kay. He will convert then this B4 union, this two-handle corresponding to that surgery for you, a concave cap for Y, and that will be a simply connected cap. But of course, for example, this strategy cannot work for Nemirovsky-Seagal example, because their example is a three manifold that it cannot be surgery on a knot. It cannot be, because it doesn't have the right first homology. Our examples might be, but we have been unsuccessful finding that knot. But of course, maybe you don't have to go to S3. Maybe it's okay that you find a knot in a different manifold where the usual obstruction is not there. Okay, so I think this was my bonus slide. I'm happy.
What obstruction are you, Kyle, using to do number two?
Oh, so the obstruction in our case is the contact loss from, or this obstruction we got it from Hegar Frohmorsch, right? We proved that if it is a contact type embedding exists, then indeed the contact loss has to vanish in certain part of Hegar Frohmology.
I see, it comes.
So yeah. And Kyler's example, as I said, theirs is really kind of the rather nice set of geometric arguments, but at least the obstruction in the case of that single rational homology sphere example they got is that it rests on this beautiful result of Nemirovsky, and I think I'm forgetting the other author for that, that there cannot be any Lagrangian Klein bottle in R4 with standard symplectic structure. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Shevchishin.
Shevchishin, yes. Did I say it correct? How you guys proved that example, Kyler? Was that good description?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Any other questions I can try to answer or anything?
Well, if there's no other questions, thanks again so much for a really nice talk.
Thank you so much for the invitation, Kyler. I really enjoyed myself.